bleeding purple and gold. From the heart of Los Angeles, this is the LakersNation.com podcast with your host, Trevor Lane.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to the show. As always, we are powered by CLNS Media and LakersNation.com, your home for everything Lakers. Today, sponsoring the show is Vivid Seats. Make sure you head over to the Vivid Seats app on your phone. Use it to get tickets to the upcoming Lakers game. Pick whatever game you want. Use the promo code LakersNation in all caps. Get 10% off. Again, check out the Vivid Seats app on your phone. Use that promo code LakersNation in all caps. Get 10% off tickets to a Lakers game. So make sure you guys go check that out. Well, the Lakers right now are in a 1-5 skid without LeBron James. He's still out dealing with that groin injury. Joining me today to talk about everything that's going on with the Lakers right now, with the walking wounded Lakers, is Alan Sliwa of ESPN. You can find him on Twitter at LakersTalkESPN. Alan, man, thanks so much for coming on, and how's everything going?
Everything's good, Trev. All hell broke loose the moment LeBron James goes down with an injury, so we got a lot to get into.
You know what? It's not even that it's just LeBron either. You know, like when when that injury happened on Christmas Day, we got that Christmas miracle where the Lakers gutted out and they still managed to, I mean, not only defeat the Warriors, but they blow out the Warriors. Just at the last moment, it looked like the Warriors were going to come roaring back and win this thing, especially with no LeBron. And then the Lakers turned it on. I thought, okay, this team, maybe they can weather the storm, even if LeBron's out. No, 1-5 with him out. And, of course, Kyle Kuzma is out injured right now, and Rajon Rondo. JaVale McGee was out with an illness. Michael Beasley was gone. When it rains, it pours. It's like all these injuries hit at the same time. And when I'm looking at the schedule, I feel like this was the worst time for all these injuries to hit.
Well, what makes it tough is, I think what's being proven is if LeBron James is not on your team, you're going to struggle significantly. And like you mentioned, look, Rondo's a big piece too. Kyle Kuzma is such a threat on offense. You know, you feel like Zoe and B.I. look lost right now, not having that like go-to player that they can go to try and get buckets. But what hurts in this stretch most is the time where you feel the Lakers could be gaining some ground on teams. You know, you're playing the New York Knicks. Today was Minnesota. Tomorrow's Dallas. You've got Detroit coming up, Cleveland and Chicago in about a week or so, where you feel like you should be gaining ground. They are free falling in the Western Conference. So at no time is an injury a good thing, but, you know, certainly for the Lakers, just based upon what the schedule looks like, these are the teams and the opponents you think you can beat. You don't pay as much attention to the Oklahoma City Thunder. You say, okay, yeah, that one's a tough one because right. It's the Thunder. But these games are the ones that I think hurt the most.
Yeah, 100%. If this stretch of the schedule had Golden State,
if it was
and
brutal,
Toronto, right? If it was just all the top teams, then you could say, hey, even with LeBron, there's a good chance they're probably going to lose these. But when we're looking at the schedule over these last few weeks when LeBron was healthy, this is where we're licking our chops going, hey, this is the point of the schedule where the Lakers can kind of fatten up their win total a little bit. This is where you build the buffer so that later on when you drop a random game and, you know, in February or whatever, it doesn't hurt as much because you tacked on all these wins right now and you beat the teams you're supposed to. Now they're losing to these teams. And that's where it starts to get scary when you look at the Western Conference playoff race, which is absolutely bonkers. I mean, there's all these different teams that could make a legitimate run, and now the Lakers are starting to slide in the standings, which means that their margin for error moving forward is going to be even less. So it feels like there's that urgency to get LeBron back, to get Kuzma back, to get these guys back and healthy, but the Lakers maintain that they're not going to push them, that they're going to wait. And I think it's the right thing to do, but still, it's hard for fans to watch right now the team struggling when they should be excelling.
Yeah, listen, I think here's the bottom line with the injuries. And big picture is we're in January. You still got the rest of the month. You still, or at least, pretty much the rest of the month. You got February, you got March, and then half of April. If the Lakers, the only thing that could be worse than the position that the Lakers are in right now is LeBron comes back too early, restrains that groin, and he's out another 4 weeks. You can kiss the season goodbye. You can forget about the playoffs. All that stuff is over. So, it's very, very important that, you know, this team, as best as they can, try to weather the storm, which I don't think they can. I think they're proving over these last six games, especially, you know, like I mentioned, Kuzma being out. I think now you have almost a 0% chance of winning any of these games. But weather the storm, if LeBron comes back healthy, let's say after that Detroit game or after that Utah game, the 13th, he makes his first appearance against the Cavs. That's another, you know, week away. Then you know you have enough time to make up ground in the Western Conference. Because the one thing that we've seen, Trev, and you know, I'm one to think that this free fall is completely just because of the injuries and nothing else. But the one thing we have seen is when the Lakers are healthy, when they got all their guns, they're as good as any team in the Western Conference, or at least they can hang with any team in the West. So you've got to just make sure when LeBron comes back, he's 100% ready for it.
You know, I'll tell you, Alan, I agree with that. I agree. I think that if they have everyone back and healthy, even if they wind up being, say, the seventh seed, the sixth seed, whatever, they're going to be that team in the playoffs that nobody wants to play. Because you're right, they can hang with anybody. I don't care what team it is. They've got a shot. They've got a puncher's chance. And, of course, the Lakers plan on adding more pieces this summer and then really making a push, you know, after that. But I'll tell you the one thing that's really getting me, and Tyson Chandler talked about this a little bit after the loss to the Wolves, is there's a sense that the team isn't playing that hard. And that's the impression I've seen. It seems like they start games off sluggish. That was my takeaway. And then they kind of pick things up a little bit as they go. But it almost seems like they're going into games feeling that they're going to lose. Like they're not going out there and competing as hard as they should be. And I would be okay with losses if I felt like the team was giving everything they had. I mean, we've seen a losing team over the last, 5 years. So we've become accustomed to seeing teams that compete, that play hard, but just don't quite have the talent to get there. We know what that looks like, and that's not what we've been seeing. And I don't know. I'm having a tough time with that part of it. I'll be honest, Alan. That's been a struggle for me. That's been a frustrating thing for me. And that's been, I know, frustrating for a lot of fans. What do you think is behind that, or is our perception off? Do you think they are competing as hard as they possibly can right now?
Well, look, I think they competed against the two games against Sacramento. Mm-hmm. I think they fought for the most part against the Oklahoma City Thunder. In the fourth quarter, they collapsed. And you know, that's a game. Lakers aren't going to beat the Thunder without the players that, you know, they obviously need. They got to have everybody healthy. That's the bottom line. OKC is just too talented. The Knicks in Minnesota, I can see a little bit more of it when, you know, you fall to the New York Knicks, you're down, I don't know, 15 points in the first quarter. Mm-hmm. You start this game down 15-1 against the Minnesota Timberwolves. I think it's a combination. Look, I don't know if it's a lack of effort. I think the word I would probably use is they look discouraged. You know, they look like a team that's starting to feel this almost mentally, like they don't have a chance to win unless they have everybody else healthy. And I feel like that's what's probably overtaken their mindset. Their mindset is becoming their lack of confidence. They don't believe that they got enough ammo to go into these fights. They don't believe that they can beat other NBA teams that are fully healthy. And I think that, to me, is what I think is sticking out more than anything else. Effort, I'll say this. There are times where, you know, I think even Luke said it, you got to go down. It's tough to beat NBA teams when you're 100% healthy, let alone when, you know, you're beat up. Mm-hmm. But he's talking about diving for loose balls, those just kind of those small things. That part, I could see it. But overall, big picture, I don't think these guys are walking into games any less hungry to win than they were. But I do feel like they are beyond discouraged and don't think they can win before tip-off even starts.
And I don't think, Alan, I wish that wasn't the case, because I don't think that's true. I don't think that they should feel like they can't win, especially when they're playing the Knicks, when they're playing the Timberwolves. Those are winnable games. Those are, to me, they should be looking at those games as opportunities, right? Opportunities to step up with somebody out and prove that they can do more than maybe what their role was previously. But you do seem to be onto something there. The body language and everything says they're kind of hanging their heads and they don't really feel like they can pull off the win. Is that something, how do you fix something like that? Is that a coaching issue? Is that just something internally from the leadership on the team? What's your takeaway from all that?
Yeah, I have to say this, Trev. These are, I know it's so easy to just point at Coach Luke Walton and you know, I'm sure doing all the work that you do for Lakers Nation, mm-hmm. you see it a lot, you know, how in whatever form you see it a lot.
Right.
I mean, look, these players are, they're grown professionals. You know, when you come to work, every single day, it might not be the best day, but you know, you gotta go in there and roll up your sleeves and do what you got to do. You got to do your job, and then hopefully collectively everybody's doing theirs. And I think that's on the players. You know, from an effort standpoint, from a belief standpoint, that's up to them. I mean, this is your profession. You get paid very, very well to do what you're doing. From tip off tonight, I'll just use the Minnesota game as an example. Mm-hmm. From tip off tonight, I don't think there was any moment where the Lakers thought they were going to walk in and win this game. And I don't think that's going to happen tomorrow, by the way, in Dallas as well. I think Dallas, you surprised tomorrow if they lose by 15? I'm not. I'm not surprised they lose every game until LeBron comes back. And maybe that changes if Kyle Kuzma comes back. But
right.
As discouraged as the players are becoming, I think, you know, as a fan, I'm starting to become discouraged too, because now in my mind, it's like all the stakes are in LeBron's hands, and everybody now just thinks, well, if LeBron doesn't play, then we don't got a shot to win. And I feel that kind of the players have that mentality. So to point the finger anywhere, you know, the players got to change their mentality. They got to think that when they do walk into these games that, you know, they do obviously have a shot to win, but they haven't proved any of that over the last six games.
Right. And you know what? You're right on the money as far as the fans. And it's easy to point fingers at Luke Walton. Your colleague at ESPN, Ramona Shelburne, reported today, sent out a tweet tonight saying that, that management, Lakers management, doesn't see this as a Luke thing. And that it's more they understand that everybody's out hurt. In fact, a notification just popped up a couple minutes ago here on my laptop. Kobe Bryant actually just tweeted out that I don't have the tweet right in front of me to read it verbatim, but he basically said, "Yeah,
I'll tell you what he says
because I'm
looking at it right now."
There's
Kobe had sent out a tweet about the Eagles winning, and it said, "Thank you, next." And then some guy tweets out, "Tell that to Luke Walton." And then Kobe says, relax, entire squad is damn near out. We're playing pretty well before that.
So everybody's getting that it's not, this isn't really on Luke. And you can say, hey, I get people being frustrated that the offense doesn't look good, right? That these players look like they don't know where to go. It's because you're missing two starters. Plus the one guy that could really hold this together without LeBron is Rondo. He's that veteran piece that was going to be the glue guy. And he's out too. So if you were to pick three guys that you really can't lose from this team, it's probably those three. And they all happen to be out at the same time. So, of course, it's going to look disjointed. Of course, it's going to look bad and everything. But I guess the big point is you still want to see this team competing as though they can win it. So hopefully that's something that comes back. Hopefully, you know, against the Mavericks tomorrow night or tonight, depending on when you're listening to this show, everybody. But hopefully we see more of that. We see that effort from the get-go. And, you know, Alan, go ahead.
No, go, keep going, actually, because I think you're gonna transition to what I was going to get into, but keep going.
Well, what I was going to talk about a little bit was the expectation here with LeBron out was that the guys who were going to step up were going to be these young guys, that we were going to see Lonzo step up. We were going to see Brandon Ingram step up. And there's this frustration that maybe that hasn't quite happened, or at least it hasn't happened consistently. And, you know, when you were talking about the whole notion that everybody's thinking right now that everything is on LeBron, right? In that Golden State game, mm-hmm. my big takeaway from that was holy crap, these guys without LeBron just beat the Golden State Warriors. How cool is that, that over the summer the narrative was LeBron doesn't care about winning basketball anymore, obviously, because he went to this team with all these kids who aren't ready to win. And then here they went and beat the Warriors without LeBron for the second half, and they still pulled off the win. That's a big feather in their cap. And now here that's kind of getting reversed. And now we're seeing a team that isn't winning without LeBron James. And a lot of the blame is, if it's not going to Luke Walton, it's being fired at Lonzo Ball and Brandon Ingram. And I wanted to see, how fair do you think that is? And what have you taken away from their performance? I don't feel like they've stepped up enough, but what do you think?
You know, I'm going to put it very bluntly. They're not ready for the moment, you know, and that's not to say that in 5 years they won't be ready for the moment, or in 3 years they won't be ready for the moment, or at some point they become mm-hmm. all-stars in the league. And I hope that for the both of them. But I don't think we can watch, you know, we hype this up. This happens so much. I get excited. I start saying to myself, oh, man, did you see B.I.'s game? He had 20 points, mm-hmm. he had 6 rebounds, he had 6 assists. I'm not going to say it again for 30 days, 20 days, you know what I mean? Lonzo will have a near triple-double, and then that's not a conversation we're going to have again for 2 weeks, 3 weeks. So the reason why I say that is, you mentioned it a little bit earlier. LeBron goes down, Rondo goes down. Now Kuzma's out too. I can't emphasize how key it is too, just not having Kuzma in the lineup, because I really think Zoe and Ingram, excuse me, they don't know who to throw the ball to. And they're dependent on to score and everything else. But those two guys are a perfect example over this six-game stretch to just look at and say, these guys are nowhere near running a basketball team. They're just not. And you know, I don't know how else to put it, but I'm going to stop telling myself that, you know, Brandon Ingram can, you know, he can be this saving grace to the Lakers, or Lonzo Ball, you know, with Rondo at it. Rondo's hurting Lonzo Ball. Remember that conversation?
Yep.
That because Rondo, right. Rondo is here, it's really affecting Lonzo's game. And then that conversation just continues. We're stunting the growth of the kids, all that stuff that, you know, has gone on over the last couple of months. Here's the bottom line. If the Lakers have any chance of making any noise, you know, in the Western Conference, it's not going to be because of Brandon Ingram and Lonzo Ball are the ones leading the pack. That's not happening. But can they be complementary pieces to LeBron and to Kuzma and to Rondo? Yes, they definitely can. Can they have nights where they go off and you're like, damn, that was awesome what Lonzo just did tonight, or B.I. really, you know, filled up the stat line, whatever the case is. Yeah, they can have them, but we, you know, we'd be lying to ourselves if we think they can do it on a consistent basis, because they've shown enough, you know, on enough nights that they can't. And that doesn't mean that in a year, 2 years, that's, you know, that could potentially change. But the whole notion of this is their opportunity to step up now because LeBron is out, you can wipe that one off the board, because I don't see anything changing. And unless the Lakers are fully healthy to depend on those two players to carry this team, I think is a little bit fairy tale right now.
And, you know, I love that, Alan, you keep saying that it doesn't mean that in a year, 2 years, 3 years, they can't do those things. Because I think in all of this, as much as we want to throw criticism at Lonzo and criticism at Brandon Ingram, and some of that is totally fair, it's easy to forget in all of that that these guys are barely 21, right? Barely 21. These are guys who are still very much figuring out who they are as a basketball player, figuring out who they are as a person. It's not something that's easy to just step into that kind of a role, to those kind of expectations, and take over. So maybe we shouldn't be surprised that they haven't really been able to handle game in, game out, running the team, right? Maybe it's unfair to ask them to do that at this stage.
Well, it's 200% unfair, because, you know, in the Western Conference and the expectations that the Lakers have, it'd be fine if the Lakers had no expectations and that they were just a lottery team like they've been over the last 5 years. But this is the one thing that I think is the most important when it comes to Lonzo Ball and Brandon Ingram. They're not bad basketball players. They're good basketball players. But they are not cornerstone pieces today. They're not. They're not hopping into the league and, you know, you can build around them instantly. That's not the case. What they can be, and I think this is exactly where they shine the most, they're team players. You know, Lonzo Ball is not a player that, I think B.I. is, first of all, not comfortable with shooting as much as he's been shooting. And I think he's not comfortable as being as much of an isolation player as he's been since he's asked to when, you know, obviously LeBron's out of the lineup. And I think Lonzo Ball, the same thing. Zoe is a player that's pass first. He's not a guy that obviously wants it. Today, he plays 23 minutes. He takes four shots. He has 0 points, which I don't make any excuse for that. But these are guys that are good teammates. They need other players around them. They are not the main guys, and hopefully that changes down the road. But as of today, if you're depending on those two to get you W's while these guys are injured, you're probably going to be getting a lot of L's in the process.
Yeah, that's a great way to put it. I've been saying that Brandon Ingram and Lonzo Ball, neither one of them are the guy. They're both a guy right now. They're a guy on the team. They're not the guy. They're not the guy that you can look to really put the team on their back. And we've seen that. So many people have been frustrated with, you know, Brandon Ingram going isolation at the end of games. And because that's what the guy does. That's what the main guy on the team is going to do. He's going to try to put the team on his back down the stretch. And Brandon Ingram's been kind of thrust into that role, and he's not ready for it. He's just not. And when he's at his best, he can be really good. He can be a good jack of all trades type player, a guy who can do a lot of different things. Lonzo Ball obviously has his talents, but they can't be counted on a game by game basis at this point. And being just 21 years old, that's okay. But what does that mean moving forward for this team where so much of their future depends on the development of these guys? The fact that they've shown that they're not ready to be the main guy on a team just yet, what does that mean for the Lakers moving forward as they try to build this team?
I think they're still okay. You know, like I'll use it as an example. Let's say LeBron comes back, Kuz is healthy, Rondo's healthy, and Lakers make a playoff push in the first round of the playoff. They're fighting in crunch time, and it's B.I. getting a huge stop on one end by blocking a shot that was a key possession that the Lakers needed on defense. And then it was Lonzo pushing the ball up court and finding Kuzma in the corner who hits a three. Like, they have they have roles on this team that I think they can thrive in. But I think the roles that they're asked to play when these main guys are out, those are not the roles that they're comfortable with. And I don't think those are their strengths. So they have roles. I think they can still be integral pieces to, you know, a run in the Western Conference, but I definitely don't think that, you know, the role they're playing right now, like I mentioned, they're just not ready for that moment. And, you know, you are right. They are 21 years old. There's some players that come into the league and are equipped and ready to go, and they have an arsenal of, you know, different repertoire of moves that they can be. That score, Devin Booker came into the league. He was ready to put up 25 if he needed to. And there are players that, you know, are like that. And maybe that's Tatum, maybe that's Donovan Mitchell, whatever the case is. These two individual players, they're team type of players. They have to have a well-equipped team around them, I think, to be at their best. And the Lakers have a good team. They're just all they're all on the IR right now.
Yeah, they definitely are. Now, in your mind. And I agree with you 100% that these guys are team players, that if you have a better team around them, they're going to look better. In your mind, does this, because I know everybody's wondering this, if you're the New Orleans Pelicans and you're seeing what's going on right now, does this maybe change your opinion of some of the Lakers' young players and perhaps their trade value if certain discussions start to take place this coming summer?
I think the value of these two players will be at the highest when everybody's back. Because if you make a deep playoff run and these guys are contributing, that's when their value is going to be at their highest. But no question about it. Right now, if you're let's not even say the Pelicans, let's just say the NBA in general, they're looking at BI and they're looking at Zoe. Zoe had 0 points today. Zero. I mean that's an awful look. You know, the Lakers are in dire need of offense right now with Kuzma and LeBron out. And obviously Rondo is walking to provide a little bit of offense, but they need offense. And for Lonzo Ball to have 0 points tonight, I think they're, you know, most definitely teams out there. Put it this way. If Laker fans are out there saying, let's trade these guys, you obviously don't think there's that much value in them. Why would another team then look at them and think, well, if you don't want them, then we got to get them. You know what I mean? So like, There's always that's the kind of funny thing that I've always thought when it comes to, you know, fans saying, well, let's trade this guy, let's trade that guy. You want to trade him because you don't think he's that good on your team. What makes you think another team wants him? So now is not a good look for these players if you're thinking trade. Get into the postseason. Make sure that they, you know, are playing team basketball and they have roles and they're able to excel at those roles. Then their value will go up.
Well, let's talk about that a little bit because we know the trade deadline is creeping up. It's a month away. The trade deadline is February 7th this year. And in fact, the Lakers are going to be on the road in Boston on February 7th. So just after the deadline, they get to go play the Boston Celtics. Are the Lakers in a situation right now where you feel like perhaps they need to make a move? Is there something that needs to be done here before the trade deadline? And is there anything that really can be done at this point?
I never felt like Trev. I just feel like, you know, Magic and Palenka, they're going to be patient. And I don't think that this is the year that they're going to make, you know, this big splash. I think they are so dependent on getting somebody to come in this summer and take that cap space that they have. And then once they do that, then everything is off the table. After that, you know, there's no player that I think they would hesitate in trading. And I think they would, you know, really, really look at how they can go out and get another, you know, type of star to come join LeBron, whoever takes that cap space, and then whoever's remaining on this roster. I just have always felt like that's the number one goal. If Paul George would have came over the summer and it was PG-13 and it was LeBron James, then I think they'd be much more open to making trades. But until they get somebody, come get that cap space, I think the fear is, you know, if you went out and got a Bradley Beal or something like that, you're just throwing names out there that have been out, you know, in the market, then you don't have enough cap space to go sign that player outright in the summer. Now you're depending on other teams that you have to make deals with. They don't have to depend on another team. That's why they freed up that cap space. So I don't think anything significant will come this summer. I mean, by the trade deadline. Maybe they make some small tweaks and changes, but I don't think anything significant.
I'm right there with you, Alan. I think the exact same thing. It's that there's no sense in trading for a guy now or making the big move now unless you feel like this is the piece that's going to put you over the edge. So if New Orleans suddenly decides, right, Anthony Davis goes to them and tells them, hey, no matter what, I'm not signing with you. I won't sign with anyone but the Lakers, and tries to force their hand. And suddenly they decide to make a trade by the trade deadline. Hey, if that's the deal that comes up, cool. Go ahead and make that. But a Bradley Beal, who's a great player, but I don't think he's that piece that pushes you to a championship. If that's the move that you're going to make, but it means sacrificing the ability to go after max contract guys this summer, I don't see that happening. And so I think that what winds up happening, because Magic and Palinka have shown in the past that they make moves, right? I mean, these guys have not been bashful about making trades. I think if anything does happen, it's going to be something more minor. Maybe we see KCP moved, right? Because we heard that rumor that he was looking to find some place that'll play him a little bit more. I mean, he has taken on a bigger role recently, but maybe it'll be one of those ancillary pieces like that, as opposed to Alonzo or a Brandon Ingram or Kuzma or any of those guys. I don't see those guys getting moved right now.
Yeah, and you know, I think actually the KCP is like, that's a good name to actually throw out there. Those 1 year deals, those expiring contracts, probably one expiring contract to another expiring contract. Lakers were obviously trying to go out there, see if they could get Trevor Ariza.
That's why that makes
those
sense.
Those types of players are the ones that I think the Lakers, you know, would continue to try and surround this team with, this roster with. Lonzo, you're not worried about his cap space. You're not worried about how much money he's making. Neither are you worried about Kuzma or Hart or Brandon Ingram. That's why these guys are such assets. I don't think these guys go this year. In the summer, everything could change. You know, if the Lakers do find somebody to come take that money, then I do feel like everything's off the table, and I wouldn't be shocked at all if then they start exploring trading away some of this youth, because they feel like, okay, we are now in a position to make a championship run. It's not about the future. It's about now.
Yeah. Yep. I could definitely see that happening. I could also see it so let's say this summer, the Lakers strike out on, say, you know, Kawhi Leonard and Kevin Durant and some of these top names, and then they're left with this cap space, and then maybe they try to package up, you know, they absorb a bad contract in addition to sending one of the young guys for whoever is out there, for somebody who's out there on the market. Then I could see them being more aggressive with a trade. Or if they do land somebody, then maybe they're more aggressive to bring in a third piece, a third player to go along with, say, LeBron and Kawhi or whoever they land. Then maybe they're more aggressive on the trade market there. But again, it doesn't make a whole lot of sense to do it right now, just because of what it means giving up, the opportunity cost of going after those max free agents.
And Trev, the pressure will be on, you know, so like, this summer, it's different than it was last summer. LeBron came. So now that LeBron's here, you pretty much got two more years after this season to try and compete for a championship. So there is pressure this summer to make sure another all-star ends up on this Lakers team and takes that cap space. And like you said, if somebody doesn't come and take that cap space, then maybe it is taken on a bad contract, whatever the case is. But they'll roll the dice a lot more starting this summer than I think they will leading up to this trade deadline.
Yeah, and I know that's, you know, Lakers fans look forward to the trade deadline and think, oh gosh, something big could happen. It still could. You never know. I mean, Magic Johnson may have something crazy that he pulls off. Rob Pelinka might work something out. But most likely, it just seems to make the most sense for them to wait until the summer to make the big move.
That big, yeah.
Now, Alan, I want to mention something here, because this was something that caught me off guard, and I know it caught pretty much everybody off guard. The Timberwolves blow out the Lakers. What was it, by 22, I think it was, by the time the final buzzer sounded. I don't know, by that. Yeah, it was 22.
And then 108-86.
And then shortly after the game, Tom Thibodeau is released. He's fired by the Minnesota Timberwolves. And I know that this is more NBA topic here, but how surprised were you by that? It's rare to see a coach get fired after his team just won in a blowout victory.
This is how confused I was. I was on, I was watching some of the NFL games, and I'm on Twitter, and I'm just looking at Twitter, and I see Tibbs' name come up. I don't really pay attention. And then I see Tibbs' name come up again. I'm like, why are they talking about Thibodeau during this Philadelphia-Chicago game? Like, I just, nothing, you know, really was processing. That's a new one. That's a new one. You blow a team out by over 20. You have I think three games over 500 since the Jimmy Butler trade. You're actually starting to make some ground in the, you know, in the Western Conference. T-Wolves are about two games out of that eighth spot, you know, from the Lakers. That's actually a key game for them. And then you fire Thibodeau. But I think this goes back. This is much deeper than that. You know, Thibodeau, he has been, I think, a disappointment, you know, with the Minnesota Timberwolves. And he has a huge role, you know, president. And he was, head coach of the organization, where you're starting to see a lot of that in the NBA go away from that. You're now starting to see those roles separate again. Mm-hmm. But it was a surprise. But, you know, going into what happened this summer, the Jimmy Butler fiasco, I mean, the Minnesota Timberwolves were only in the media for negative things over the last 6 months, you could say. So I think they just want to turn a new leaf. They want to try something different. And I think they're probably happy with what they got with Robert Covington and, you know, and Saric. And I think they're now in a position to kind of continue to build with this unique young core that they have. And they probably want to start with a new coach as well.
Yeah, they've got some interesting pieces. The only thing I could even look at, and, you know, Tibbs has a reputation around the league for just grinding his stars, his star players, his starters, playing them just tons and tons of minutes, ungodly minutes. And that's, you know, that was part of the knock on signing Luol Deng when the Lakers did, was, hey, you know, not only is he a veteran player, but he played for Tom Thibodeau for so many years, which means he's got really high mileage on him. This is a guy who played a ton of minutes. In a game where they were blowing out the Lakers pretty much the entire way, right? From buzzer to buzzer. And Karl Anthony Towns plays 35 minutes. Andrew Wiggins plays 36. That's a fairly heavy workload for a game where they could have been getting them rest. That was about the only thing I could point to that would have maybe been like the final straw or something. It seems like this was a decision that was already made. It was just the timing was curious, but for whatever reason, they decided that that it's time for a new look in Minnesota. So we'll see what happens from here. I wonder if they might now look to shake things up, because so much of the Thibodeau methodology meant bringing in these ex-Bulls players. So if you now have someone else in charge, what's this roster going to look? Are they going to completely switch things around? I wonder if they're going to be pretty aggressive making moves at the trade deadline now to kind of change things up and clear the air from the Thibodeau era.
I think they just got to go young. You know, they got to build towards the future. Mm-hmm. You know, you're pretty much, Karl Anthony Towns is your centerpiece. I don't know how much, I think Wiggins has probably been a little bit of a disappointment, but I like Covington. I like Sark, like I mentioned. So I think they're, you know, the Taj Gibsons of the world, some of these guys that are a little bit more veterans. Maybe they find a way to get rid of some of those players and see if they could take advantage of playoff teams wanting more vet pieces.
Yeah, agreed. I could definitely see them maybe making some moves to add some future picks and things of that nature. Or maybe they go the other direction. They decide that they're a playoff team and that's the way they want to go, and they become buyers at the trade deadline. I think that's the one thing that, you know, we were talking a bit ago about the trade deadline. That's going to be really fascinating to watch, because when you look at the Western Conference, pretty much every team except for the Phoenix Suns could talk themselves into being one move away from really making a run, right? I mean, all of these teams.
Literally.
Yeah. So,
I mean, the Pelicans are the furthest out other than the Suns, and they're three games out. So
we could see some craziness go on, even if it's not the Lakers. We could see some teams going out there and really trying to chase after a team. You look at teams like, say, the Atlanta Hawks, the Chicago Bulls. We could see teams like that are definitely out of it, starting to sell off some of their players. And who knows who in the West might make. I mean, hey, we just saw the Memphis Grizzlies go make a trade for Justin Holiday, who's not a star by any means, but they're trying to improve. They're trying to get better. We don't have as many teams throwing in the towel and tanking this year as we have in years past, because the Western Conference seems to be so close, and the Golden State Warriors have faltered a little bit to where they at least look mortal-ish. So I feel like teams are feeling a little bit more inspired and feeling like they actually have a shot this year.
It's funny. I think there are teams out there. So look at, let's say, the Memphis Grizzlies. Like, that's a team that should start selling off. You know,
they should.
Even if they got into the postseason. But I don't know how much value Mike Conley has, but he's a nice player. You know, why not start looking at? You don't want to be. I mean, even if you make the postseason, Lakers are a different. They're in a kind of different breed. But if Lakers were in the eighth, you think they can make some noise potentially, especially if Warriors are not in the first seed. You know, let's say Warriors continue to just kind of stay where they are, and you got to go up against Denver in the first round. You know, you still want to take that chance. But some of these other squads out there that even the Pelicans, the Memphis Grizzlies, you know, now might be the time where, you know, you kind of start selling off. It's different for the Jazz, the Kings. These are younger teams that, you know, they're looking at the next 2-3 years to, you know, make a little bit more noise in the West. But there are teams that have been just, they've been making it to the playoffs and they've made no noise. And Memphis and New Orleans kind of come to my mind right away.
Yeah, I agree. I would think that the smart thing for the Memphis Grizzlies to do right now would be to start selling off pieces and take advantage of the fact that there are these teams that now think they can make a push and try to extract some assets and everything. But that doesn't seem to be the directions they want to go, since they just gave up two second round picks in order to bring in Holiday to try to add more help. So it's going to be interesting to see how things all play out once the trade deadline gets closer. But flipping back to Lakers, they've got obviously a matchup with the Dallas Mavericks coming up. Then they've got the Detroit Pistons, then the Utah Jazz. These are all winnable games. Do you think at this point it just hinges on Kyle Kuzma? What's your prediction here for this next week ahead before we call it a night here, Alan?
So I did this yesterday. I did my Lakers talk show yesterday, and probably not going to give out too favorable of an answer. I was mentioning these next three games. I said Minnesota, Dallas, and Detroit. Mm-hmm. And I predicted them, and I said, tell me why I would give the Lakers a win in any three of these games. And the point that I'm making is that they're showing that they clearly cannot win without at least those three players out. And then, you know, hopefully if Kuzma comes back. But to be frank, I don't feel good about these upcoming games. I don't feel good about any game until LeBron does come back. And when LeBron comes back, I feel really good about a lot of the games. That's the impact that he has. That's how unbelievable of a player he is. I spent some time talking about this yesterday. I said, you know, if you want to talk about this MVP chase and who's the best player, is it James Harden? Is it this? I'm like, just stop doing it. It's LeBron James. LeBron, without the Lakers... Lakers were a lottery team last year. He comes. They're sitting in fourth place in the Western Conference. He goes out for six games. They go 1-5. The Cavs are 8-32 this year. That's how significant LeBron James is. And if he's not in the lineup, and I don't care if it's the Dallas Mavericks, the Detroit Pistons, the Utah Jazz, these are all three teams that are at 500 or below 500. I don't feel good about any of those games until LeBron comes back.
Agree with you. Unfortunately, Alan, I unfortunately agree. I wish we could say, hey, they, and you know, maybe they'll surprise us. Maybe they'll pull out some of these games. If Kuzma comes back, I think they have a much better shot, right? I mean, we know Kuzma, he traveled with the team, so maybe there's some hope that he'll play. But if he comes back, then at least there's a puncher's chance, because right now what they don't have is scoring, and he can provide that.
Well, and that's what a couple times in our conversation, Trav, like I kind of mentioned Kuz's name, because Kuz's, I mean, I think his value is incredibly rising. You know, like we're talking about the value of Brandon Ingram and Lonzo Ball, but Kuz is showing that Brandon Ingram looks for Kuzma. We know Lonzo Ball looks for Kuzma. LeBron James looks for Kuzma. Kuzma, you know, that's 20 points a night that the Lakers are literally missing, and I'm not even counting LeBron and Rondo. So if Kuzma is playing in these games, they do have a better chance, but until they get really fully healthy, it's going to be a tough go.
Oh, yeah. I mean, we talk about value. We talk about contracts and everything. Kyle Kuzma, this season, next season, and the one after combined is making just a little over $7 million. That's insane. Jeez. That is incredible, incredible value in the NBA. If you're going to build a championship team and you've got a piece like that on your roster, then go out and get you 20 points and basically cost nothing on your salary cap. That's such a huge advantage. So, that's in this dark cloud that we're in right now, there are some silver linings. That's certainly one of them when you look at the contract of Kyle Kuzma and the possibilities that opens up for the Lakers moving forward.
You know, Travin, I've said this and I'll continue to say it. I mean, I like the team. I really, really do. I mean, I do feel when we are healthy, we're going to start getting right back into the thick of things. You know, just a matter of when we're healthy, but the team is talented, and Kuzma's talented, and Lonzo's talented, and Hart's talented, and Tyson offers something, and JaVale. They all are. It's a good team that's been assembled together. But when you literally lose that beam that holds up the foundation of your home, things crumble, and that's what LeBron is. So until he comes back and you kind of lay that foundation again, we're going to have to just kind of wait and see if this team can stay above water. And currently, I said this like maybe about a week ago, I'm like, can we stay above water? Right now, not much staying above water.
Yeah, not so much right now. Right now, it's more just, you know, sinking straight to the bottom. But hopefully, you know, hopefully the injury bug will leave the Lakers alone from here, and we can get some good health. Alan, thanks so much for hopping on here with me. I mean, tough time in the season to chat Lakers basketball, but I think we covered a lot here, got through a lot of different topics, and hopefully everybody listening to this isn't too down on the Lakers, because I want the overall theme to be that, hey, this is still a good team when they come back healthy. They're just kind of in a tough spot right now.
No, no question about it, Trev. Appreciate you having me on, and hopefully the team can start turning things around here in the next week or so.
Yes, yeah, we'll be hoping to see it. Hopefully these guys get healthy and get back out there. Everybody, make sure you go follow Alan on Twitter at Lakers Talk ESPN, and make sure you check out his show, Lakers Talk, on ESPN 710. Make sure you guys go give that a listen. Always a great show. I like to download it straight to my phone. If you guys listen to the podcast version of it, go download it if you want, or listen to it live on the radio. Great Lakers talk on there. Guys, thanks so much for listening. Appreciate it. Everybody, hang in there. Hang in there. I know the Lakers are struggling right now. 1-5 in the last few. Hopefully they'll pick up some wins here and turn this ship around. But for now, the sky's not falling. Everything's going to be okay once they get healthy. So everybody hang in there for right now. Make sure you guys head over to LakersNation.com, your home for everything Lakers, for all your latest breaking Lakers news. Check out our Instagram page at Lakers Nation Official. Follow us on Twitter at Lakers Nation. Our Facebook page is at Lakers Nation as well. Check us out on social media, all kinds of great Lakers content on there. And also make sure you check out the Lakers Nation postgame show. We're doing that on Facebook Live. That's myself and Jas Kang. After every single game, we break down all the action and take comments straight from you guys, straight from the fans. So go ahead and join in the discussion. Check us out on the Lakers Nation Facebook page right after every single Lakers game. My name's Trevor Lane. You can follow me on Twitter at Trevor_Lane. Till next time. See ya.